In the last episode, we spoke about how operationalizing best practice into technology used by our teams was the most effective driver of its adoption at scale. In this episode, we'll be exploring that approach in more detail, as well as defining what we mean by technology enablement at QuantumBlack. To bring those concepts to life, we'll be talking to a colleague of mine, and also our head of product, Alan Hannaway. Alan, why don't we start with you introducing yourself?
Hey, James. My name is Alan Hannaway. I'm a senior principal product manager at QuantumBlack. I actually joined QuantumBlack 4 years ago at a really interesting time in the first 6 months post-acquisition by McKinsey. Back then, we were thinking and putting together the early thoughts around how are we going to leverage technology to help us scale, to support our ambitions for scale. Today, a lot of my time is spent on product strategy. So seeking ways to identify opportunities where we should be maybe investing and building our own solutions to tech enable how we work.
And we both work for an organization called QB Labs. Can you talk a little bit about what QB Labs is and its role within QuantumBlack?
So QB Labs is QuantumBlack's technology development team. It's a fully balanced team of product managers and engineers and designers and creators who have been building technology to help underpin how we do our analytics delivery work. The team in its current form is about 2 years old. However, we started building the QB Labs team 4 years ago when we had started adding detail to this thesis that we could leverage technology to help us achieve scale. Our thinking around scale at the time wasn't just around let's get more people, it wasn't just around can we do more with less, but rather holistically on scale, we were thinking across all vectors, like how do we develop new capabilities as a group, or how do we reduce risk in how we work, or how do we ensure that our teams have a great experience when we do our analytics delivery work. And today, QB Labs are the group of people who build a lot of that technology to help us answer all of those questions and achieve that scale.
Let's start there. How does QB Labs figure out what technology to build for the teams?
We never start with technology first. All of the technology solutions we have built to date in QB Labs have been anchored on pain points that have been captured by our practitioners during their project work. And when we make these decisions to build a new technology solution, there are three things that influence and motivate the decision. The first is the pain point known and widely accepted to be a pain point that our practitioners have experienced? When this is true, these are pain points that have been seen across multiple projects. They are pain points that constantly get in the way of our teams, ones that they haven't been easily able to overcome through project work themselves. These are great motivating signals for us to maybe invest in building our own technology. I think secondly, the pain point needs to be something that QB Labs is best positioned to solve. And what I mean by this is a lot of solutions may already exist to the problem that we're facing that we just haven't used yet. So we actively encourage our teams to experiment with the latest technology available on the market today. And we've learned this the hard way, where, you know, today the modern workbench of a data scientist or a data engineer is significantly different to the workbench a data engineer might compose for themselves 3 years ago. And the reason for this pace of change is there is a huge amount of innovation happening today around how to do analytics and how to do it well in the enterprise. And we want to be able to leverage all of this thinking. We see this not least with large tech companies open sourcing and making available large, sophisticated solutions to some of these pain points that we're experiencing that, you know, we should just use rather than build our own solutions for. So I think what this means for QB Labs is we want to be sure we're investing in the right problems. And these are ones that the market isn't solving for us and we believe won't be solving anytime soon. And I think, you know, thirdly and finally, the signal that might motivate our decision is, do we know how to solve this problem? And solve this problem for us means, can we actually build a solution that all of our practitioners would choose to use, such that we could then scale that solution or that piece of technology to completely remove this pain point from our work? And what we find when ideas and opportunities sit in this sweet spot, this is when we're best able in QB Labs to, you know, deploy teams to then go and create new outcomes, new ways of working through technology enablement that help us scale our ability to operate with best practice.
So we're building lots of different technology products in labs. Maybe we can bring this mission to life a little bit more by focusing on one of those products. We've seen lots of examples of Studio in the past webinars, so let's use that as an example. What is Studio, and what were the pain points we were attempting to solve by creating it?
Studio is a knowledge management and workflow tool that we built to help underpin some of the key activities that happen in a project. So for example, consider the work of a data engineer. It is their job, typically at the start of a project, to understand what data is available to the project. And when they answer that question, they have to find ways to communicate that understanding to the rest of the project team. For us, this was a real pain point, but we had seen lots of innovation by our data engineers in how they might do this, addressing some of the complexity around, well, what level of detail should we capture about a data landscape for a problem? How should we structure that information? How should we visualize it? We had seen our teams grapple with this pain point and innovate and create novel ways of doing this. And this was motivation for us to build Studio to capture all of that best practice and distribute it through the technology that was Studio to every other team who could benefit from doing this.
Studio is a mature multi-tenant piece of software, though, right? So what's the journey between identifying that pain point and getting to the state of maturity that Studio has as a product? What does that evolution look like? How do you know you're building the right thing?
I think you're right in thinking about the development of this technology like a journey. Today, Studio serves more than just data engineers. It serves translators, data scientists, project managers, project stakeholders, project sponsors. And what has happened over the past 18 months in developing Studio is we've identified countless pain points and problems where there was opportunity for us to build technology to scale best practice against these challenges. In fact, in the last 18 months, we've done this over 200 times. And what is behind those 200 software releases of different versions of Studio is a very detailed analysis of very specific problems that our teams face in trying to implement their projects with best practice that we have encapsulated in the tool and distributed to everybody else who can benefit from using it.
So be honest, how many people or how many teams used iteration number one versus how many teams are now choosing to use iteration number 200?
We shipped the very first version of Studio to 10 available projects at the time. And of those 10 projects, all of them tried to use it. However, 8 of them chose to stop using it because the tool wasn't performing against their expectation to overcome some of these pain points and challenges. And that was a really interesting insight for us. We realized that to actually achieve best practice at scale, we need to capture this detail as to what is blocking us from overcoming this challenge and use that specific detail and our attempts at overcoming it to form the backlog of what we build next in our technology. And you know, that feedback from the 8 projects who didn't use Studio led to the next set of versions that got us eventually to 10 projects using Studio. Today, Studio has been used by over 220 projects around the firm. And what we get through this constant dialogue of feedback is a constant innovation cycle, allowing us to always track the latest pain points and problems that our teams face.
So in its current state, What are the benefits unlocked by those 200 odd teams now choosing to use Studio? Why do they use it on their projects?
I think that's a great question, and it forces you to think about what value technology delivers over time. In Studio's case, we thought the pain point and opportunity was solely around, in the early days, capturing and managing data knowledge and sharing that with the project team. And we built a tool in Studio that could allow data engineers compile a data dictionary. However, data engineers are using it very differently today in ways we didn't necessarily design for. Now we hear our teams saying Studio is a great way to demonstrate the importance of very technical work streams to non-technical stakeholders who don't fully understand the importance of these work streams. And this means that we'll continue to expect the value in Studio to change and evolve over time, just like the needs and pain points and opportunities for us to build technology for our practitioners will continue to change over time.
Okay, so that's benefits to the team. What about at an organizational level? What's the benefits to the organization by teams using technology like Studio?
The marker of success here is really adoption of the technology. When you successfully innovate and iterate your technology to keep pace with evolving user needs, you start to see all practitioners leveraging this technology in their workflows. And that delivers, at an organizational level, a benefit we call consistency at scale. What we mean by consistency at scale is really a composite of benefits. So take, for example, risk. With this in place, and with large-scale adoption of the technology, you've reduced the need for practitioners to reinvent or create new or novel ways that have been untested in the past, ways to overcome challenges in their workflow. Similarly, you get higher quality output because of the hundreds of iterations of the technology. You've produced a stable way to consistently deliver high quality output across all project work. Another we see is team experience. Practitioners are just happier when they don't have to constantly put out the same fires in the heat of project work, but can rely on technology to act as scaffolding and signposting through problem solving because of this system that's in place.
Okay, so we can put a big tick next to consistency at scale. What's next for the technology enablement mission at QB? What's the next frontier for labs and the technology we're building?
A new opportunity we are seeing after achieving consistency at scale are ways to achieve what we're calling efficiency at scale. So what we mean here is we're able to recognize patterns in the output of our project work that will allow us potentially re-leverage that knowledge on future similar work. So for example, consider the data engineer or the data scientist who are building and producing project outputs like data dictionaries, data models, structured expertise in the form of hypothesis lists, feature metadata, and descriptions. When you have a structured and consistent way of producing these outputs, they become asset candidates for future work. And we believe this is an exciting new area for innovation where technology enablement can not only underpin key workflows, but we can augment it with existing knowledge based on our experience of problem solving in the past.
Awesome. So for any organizations or teams that are about to start their technology enablement journey, Alan, what would be your top five tips for them? What should they be thinking about when they start their own journey?
I think the first thing is around mission. So being very clear and intentful in what it is that you are trying to achieve. For us, it was around what we spoke about today: tech enablement, consistency at scale, what is now efficiency at scale for us. But I think having a clear mission where leadership, top leadership, are fully bought in and are behind that mission is key. Second, I would say, is around building community. and particularly building community around that mission. It is important to create an ownership mindset where, for us, through our guilds, it was easy to create a sense of ownership for data engineering on this mission or data science on this mission, but certainly to seek ways to give this mission to practitioners so they don't feel like it's not theirs. Number three, I would say, is around setting principles. So similar to our choose to use principles, identify principles that are appropriate to the mission that you're on and adhere to those principles with discipline. I think four is tireless innovation. Expect there to be hundreds of iterations and attempts to get this right. And maybe finally, five, I would say, seek ways to shorten the innovation loop. Reduce the time between iterations as fast as you can. Because the faster you can learn, the faster you can scale.
Thanks a lot, Alan. In the final episode, we're going to revisit some of the key milestones we've hit in the past few years while attempting to codify our own ways of working, and then cover some of the key learnings from the previous four episodes that hopefully might help other organizations setting out on a similar journey. Thank you very much.